other in the morning.
All are meeting indoors again for the first time since March.
It looks a little different, but the more things change, the more things stay the same in so many ways. But we want to welcome you all. Also, during this first hymn, remember to wear your mask, hum along, or just listen to Charlie play. Or you can sing to yourself. We're not going to stand and sing out loud, but you can sing to yourself, or hum along, or just listen to Charlie as we sing Holy, Holy, Holy. Different, as you all know, But our prayers are going to be with you. So even though things are different, things can still be good. So I hope that you will know that, that even though things are not going to be the same, it's not going to be the same start of the school year, things can still be good. And so I hope that your school year will be a great year, that you'll have a great time. It can be a good time for each and every one of you. So first, we're going to have a prayer for you all. And then we're going to let you all introduce yourselves and what grade you're going into and what you're looking forward to this year for school. So let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you and praise you for each of these youth and children. We just thank you that they are present here. We thank you that they are ready for school. And Lord, even though it's going to look a little different, Lord, I know it can be a good year. I pray that for each one of these children and youth, that it will be a great year. It will be different, but Lord, I pray that it will be a great year for them. Help them to see joy. Help them to see love. Help them to see you in this year. Help them to see the good things that are going to occur, the blessings that you have in store for their lives. Lord, I know you have blessed each one of these children and youth in many ways over the years, and I know you have wonderful blessings in store for them this year, and I thank you for that. And I just pray for each heart that is present and standing here, just bless them, touch them, may they feel your presence in a wonderful, wonderful way. Lord, we also lift up all the other children that are going to be starting the school tomorrow and the youth. We pray that you would bless each heart of each child that is going into the school systems, whether it's here in Weaverville or in North Carolina or throughout this country or throughout this world. Lord, as they go back to school, we just pray that each one would be able to know wherever they are at, whatever country they are at, that they can know that this year can be a great year for them. It will look different, but it can still be a great year. And we thank you for that, Lord. Bless each heart, for it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen. We'll go from the youngest to the oldest. So, Jennifer, you may need to lift up Rachel so that she can, you know, speak here. So you'll need to take off your mask when you speak into the microphone. Yeah, just go ahead and lift her up and say your name.
Isabella, kindergarten.
Kindergarten. And what are you looking forward to in kindergarten, Rachel? Kindergarten's going to be fun, Rachel. Next, youngest.
My name is Ellen, and I'm going to be the...
I'm looking forward to seeing my friends and getting to sleep in.
sit down next time. Thank you for coming and being here, and hopefully you have a great, great year. At this time, we're going to ask if the teachers, if there's any of the teachers, I know Jamie's here, is there any other teachers or workers in the school system? Well, we're going to pray for Jamie first, and then we'll let her share a little bit about her excitement about the school year and everything. But let's pray. Gracious Lord, we just thank you so much for Jamie and her desire to work and to be with the children and help them and the youth. And Lord, just pray that she would have a great year. It's going to be different. It's not going to be the same. But Lord, I believe it can be a great year. I believe it can be a great year because you are present with her in this. We just pray that you would touch her heart, help her to experience your presence, help her to be your light to these youth and children. And Lord, I just thank you for that. I thank you for her willingness to serve you in this way. And just pray that that all teachers, all the employees of the school system will have a great year, that each and every one of them will experience your presence and be able to be a light to you, to each of the youth and children. Lord, we just pray for every teacher, whether it's here in Weaverville or in North Carolina or in the United States or throughout the world. Lord, be with the teachers this year. It's going to be a challenging year, but be with them and help them to see that with your blessings, this can be a wonderful, awesome year. We thank you for that. For it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. So Jamie, come up. No, come up. Say your full name, and then just what classes you'll be teaching, how you'll be doing it. Gracious Lord, thank you for hearing our prayers. Amen. At this time, we are not going to be passing the offering plates, but we do want to say thank you for continuing to be faithful and to give. I don't know, Zach, would you like to share just a few words of anything about the offerings that have come, because it's been almost 3 months now, and people have been faithful and generous. And yeah.
outside listening. Thank you. Everyone has very generously supported the church. We haven't been, we've been meeting outside some, but there were several weeks there where we just didn't have anything, and we're able to continue. We know all of our bills are here. We still have a mortgage. We still have employees to pay. We still have utilities. We've been able to continue all that. We are a little bit behind in our expenses versus our giving, but that's pretty normal for the church, even in a normal year. We kind of have the summer slide, like the children going back to school, they kind of slide a little bit, but so does their church attendance and their church giving. But I appreciate everyone, and I'm glad that you were able to give, and we're really not as far behind as I thought we might have been. So thank you, and continue to support the church in the next few months, and hopefully we can safely get back to worshiping normal soon. Thank you.
And at this time, Charlie is going to bless us with his talents and special music. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you so much for your many blessings. We thank you that you are present for us and that you are touching our hearts and lives. Thank you for that. And now we pray, Lord, as we look into your word, that you will pray and bless us through your word, because your word encourages us and touches us, inspires us. Help us to see you this morning through your word. For it is in the name of the Father, Son, and Spirit, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. A reading from the Gospel of John, the 3rd chapter, starting with verse 1. Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. Jesus answered him, Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born anew, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said to him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wills, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know whence it comes or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to Jesus, How can this be? This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. In this passage, just a little bit of a background as we kind of see this exchange between Nicodemus and Jesus. Nicodemus was a Pharisee, and the Pharisees were the ones, along with the Sadducees, who were the religious leaders who wanted to experience the kingdom of God. They wanted to be close and to make sure that they got into heaven, make sure that they got into the kingdom of God. Well, as humans, sometimes, you know, it's hard to understand or say, well, exactly how does that happen? Well, they wound up creating, some say as many as 800 some rules and laws that you had to abide by. And you had to abide by each and every one if you wanted to get in and see the kingdom of God. And so it stemmed all the way from washing the hands. You had to wash your hands a certain way. You had to wash your body a certain way. You had to wash your feet, you know, a certain way after you got into somebody else's home. You had to eat the right foods. You couldn't eat just anything. You had to eat the right foods. You had to have them cooked the right way. You had to have them prepared the right way. Everything about your whole life was regimented right down to the last detail. And you had to keep each and every detail all the way if you wanted to see the kingdom of God. So here was Nicodemus, a Pharisee, who was used to working his way into heaven. That's basically what they were doing. They were working their way into heaven. And here was Nicodemus working his way through heaven on a physical level, and he comes to meet Jesus because he sees something different in Jesus. He comes to him by night. You know, we don't know why he came to see Jesus at night. We don't know whether it was because, you know, there was less crowds and he knew that he'd be able to talk with Jesus more openly without a lot of people around. Or we don't know whether he didn't want to be seen by the other Pharisees or Sadducees, that he was going to this radical preacher, you know, to talk with him. We're not sure why Nicodemus went to Jesus at night. But he went to Jesus at night, and he asked Jesus this question. He says, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. And of course, he's setting this up because he was just about to ask Jesus a question, and Jesus cuts in. Jesus interrupts him, and Jesus gives Nicodemus what Nicodemus needed to hear, not what Nicodemus wanted to hear. Jesus interrupted Nicodemus, and he said, Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again,
He cannot see the kingdom of God. Now, Jesus knew right away that Nicodemus, being a Pharisee, was obsessed with trying to be a part of the kingdom of God. He was obsessed with everything in his life, keeping every little specific detail in his life so that he could one day attain the kingdom of God. And Jesus knew this about Nicodemus. He knew that with him being a Pharisee, that he was obsessed with being a part of the kingdom of God. And so the one thing that Jesus said was, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God." Well, of course, now this threw Nicodemus just completely because, you know, Jesus didn't say, okay, you have to keep these 800 rules and regulations that you've been keeping all these years of your life. You've been so good, Nicodemus. You've kept them. You know, you are, instead of saying, hey, Nicodemus, you're on the right track. You're working your way. You're doing good. Keep it up. Jesus threw a monkey wrench in Nicodemus's thinking. And all of a sudden, it didn't make sense to Nicodemus. And Nicodemus responded and he said, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Now, Nicodemus was being Nicodemus. He was being a Pharisee. He was saying, okay, if this is something that we have to do to enter the kingdom of God, how do I do it? I don't know how. It doesn't make sense to me. But Nicodemus was thinking once again more on that physical line of doing things. It's the things that you work your way. You do it and you mark it off. Done that. I do it this way. I do it the right way. You know. And so Nicodemus was trying to figure out, okay, if this is something that is a part of experiencing the kingdom of God, how can I mark it off? How can I do this so that I can know that, you know, that I can be a part of the kingdom? Jesus responded and he said, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Jesus is saying, Nicodemus, you're looking at this all wrong. You're looking at it about what you can do. You know, you're making sure that you've got everything marked off. You wash your hands properly. You wash your body properly. You eat properly. You prepare your feast properly. You're doing all these things and you're marking everything off. You're doing everything right, but there's more to life with God than the physical things of life. Flesh is flesh, but spirit is spirit. And what he was telling Nicodemus is you have to start thinking a little bit differently, Nicodemus. It's not just about what we do to work our way into heaven. It's about what God does to allow us. And what we do to work our way into heaven is what God does for us that allows us to enter into heaven. This was a completely new thought for Nicodemus. And the Pharisees, they couldn't imagine this. You know, it's not about what I do. I've lived my whole life about making sure that everything I do is right and proper and working my way. You know, it's amazing how many times I've talked with church people over the years, and I'll say, you know, what makes you a Christian? What makes you know that you're one day going to be in heaven? And they start listing off the things, you know, well, I go to church at least every once in a while. You know, I read the Bible every once in a while. I do, you know, I pray, you know, I do this, you know, I attend Rotary or I attend, you know, whatever it is that they do. But they list off a number of things that they do. On a physical level of life. It's amazing how many people, when you ask them, what is it that gets us into heaven, they will start listing off works, the works that they do. And I've had, I don't know how many people tell me, oh, I hope I've just done enough to be worthy to get there. I hope I've done enough that I'll be worthy to get there. You see, what they're saying is, it's what I do that depends whether I get to heaven or not. What Jesus is telling Nicodemus is, you're thinking about it all wrong. It's not what we do. It's not about getting everything right. It's not about following 800 rules or whatever the rules we may have in our society of doing good things. It's not about what we do, what we do. Jesus is saying, it's not what we do, it's what God does. It's what God does for us. We can't work our way into heaven, no matter how good we are. If you could work your way into heaven, Nicodemus would have been the one to do it. He kept, as a Pharisee, he kept those 800 some rules and regulations right down to the last specific detail. If anyone, in any time or place, could have done what we try to do, which is work our way into heaven, it would have been Nicodemus and the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They were very obsessed and specific about what they did. They were truly good working people trying to work their way into heaven. But Jesus is saying, Nicodemus, you've missed the mark. You're not thinking about this the way that God wants you to think about it. It's not what you do. It's about what God is about to do to allow you to enter into the kingdom of heaven. And then the way Jesus expressed it a little bit further so that he could understand, he says, do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wills, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. What he was telling Nicodemus is, God is going to come into your heart. It's like the wind. We can't determine the wind. We can't control the wind. I mean, we can turn on fans and make an imitation of the wind, but we can't control the wind. The wind, you know, we don't know where it starts, where it goes from. But I tell you what, when on a hot summer night, when you're sitting on the porch on a hot summer humid night, that little bit of cool breeze of a wind feels awful good, doesn't it? That feels so good. Or when you're at the beach and all of a sudden it's been a hot day and you're just hot and the sun has been beating down and all of a sudden that breeze that comes in off the ocean, off that water, doesn't that feel really good? We can't tell or we can't control when the wind or the breeze will come, but we can experience it. We can feel it. We can know it. And that's what Jesus is telling Nicodemus. He says, Nicodemus, you can't control God. By all the things, you're trying to control God by saying, well, God's got to allow me into heaven if I do these 800 things right. So I'm going to work and really work my way into heaven and do these things. And he's going to have to let me in because I'm good. And I've done this well. But Jesus is saying, no, no. We can't control God just like we can't control the wind. But we can experience him. We can feel it and know that he surrounds us. Have you ever been hot and humid and all of a sudden the breeze picks up and it's just all around you and it just feels so good? You feel it on your face, you feel it in your body, and it just feels so good and it just surrounds you. Jesus is saying that's the way God is. Where God chooses to be, he will choose to touch you and choose to let you be a part of his kingdom. By what he chooses to do, not by what we have done. We can't work our way into heaven. We have to just be excited and happy that God has chosen us to be a part of his kingdom. Because you see, Jesus, God sent Jesus to die on the cross, that we might be able to be born again, that we might be able to be born in that Spirit. We can't control it. We can't determine it. We can't say, okay, God, by what I do, I'm going to be born of the Spirit. That doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way. God chooses to come into our hearts and lives when we ask Him to. It's His action that allows us to be a part of the kingdom of God, not our actions. Wow. Doesn't that just relieve you to know that, wow, we have been blessed because you wouldn't be here, I mean, you wouldn't be listening if you had not experienced the Spirit of God, if you had not known that God was present and alive. We would not be here if it wasn't for the fact that we have been privileged to experience the Spirit of the living God, to touch our hearts, to touch our minds and our spirits. We have been privileged not because of what we have done, not because of the positions in the church we've taken, not because we were a preacher or because we're one of the leaders in one of the committees, not by anything that we have done, but it's because God has chosen us to bless us and to allow us to be a part, to experience, just like we experience the wind, to experience His presence as we are born again. Now, for those who do not quite understand this, Nicodemus didn't either. Nicodemus said to him, how can this be? How can this be? If you're not sure, if you're asking that question like Nicodemus, then I want you to know it's not what we do. It's not our good works that get us into heaven. It's the fact that we pray and ask Jesus to come into our hearts and lives, and that we allow the Spirit of God to come into our hearts, and we are born anew. We are born again into the presence of the Spirit of God. And when that happens, we don't have to ask, how can this be? When you have asked Jesus into your heart, you will know. Just as surely as you will know that breeze and that wind. Sometimes God's presence in our lives is going to come in like a hurricane. The wind's going to come in and knock us over. Sort of like a little girl who was late for church one day, and she was running and she was saying, God, you know, help me to get there on time. And then all of a sudden, this strong wind came up behind her, and she wound up tripping and falling. And she looked up and she said, well, God, I didn't mean push me. Sometimes when God's presence in our lives comes into our hearts, and when we ask Him to come into our lives and we're born again, it will come in like a hurricane, and there's no doubt about it. Sometimes it's like that. Slight cool breeze on a hot summer night as we sit on the porch. But we know. You won't have to ask like Nicodemus, how can this be? If you have the Spirit of God in your heart and life, you know. And praise God, it's not what we have done. It's what God done in Jesus for us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's sing our last hymn once again with mask and listen along or sing along with Charlie. I love thy kingdom, Lord.
Thank you.
may we go forth in the love of God, knowing that it's not what up to us that gets us into heaven. It's up to God. It's what God does in our hearts and lives. So because of that, let us stand and sing together the doxology.